Talking on the topic of chronic traumatic encephalopathy today. So it has been in talk very recently, and there are many players, especially athletes, who have been affected by chronic traumatic encephalopathy. So recently there was a player named Philip Adams. He's an ex-NFL player, and he was accused of killing 5 people along with himself, and his brain is being studied for CTE. And he's probably almost diagnosed having CTE. And there's another player, and he was known as the US bobsledder. So after his death, unfortunately, he was confirmed to have a CTE. So what is the definition? The definition is chronic traumatic encephalopathy has been defined as a progressive neurodegenerative disease caused by repetitive head trauma. It was first described in 1928. When Dr. Harrison Martland, a New Jersey medical examiner, he began to notice a constellation of symptoms, especially in boxers, describing them as punch drunker, which literally means dementia of the fighter, and the medical term is dementia pugilistica. So many of the affected athletes, mostly retired, they have struggled in their later years with depression, substance abuse, anger, memory, motor disturbances, and suicide. So what is dementia pugilistica? So pathologically, in the brain of the boxers, those who unfortunately died, it showed both gross and microscopic abnormalities, including cerebral atrophy, hemorrhages, scarring of the cerebellum and other areas, neuronal loss, gliosis, NFTs, which is called neurofibrillary tangles. The clinical syndrome included both cognitive and motor signs. Thus, the term dementia pugilistica, which means dementia of the fighter. So what is the epidemiology? So mainly, it is because of the traumatic brain injury or concussion, which is the most common neurological disorder, accounting for approximately 90% of all the brain injury. So such injuries are common in athletes with an estimate of 1.6 to 1.8 million. Sports-related concussion just in the US. So, and this is a gross underrepresentation because many of the players, they don't seek medical attention or they don't vocalize as well. This is a very amazing news which recently came. So UCLA studies find that CTE in living former NFL player. So this cartoon CTE says, go ahead, you take a knee and I'll take a brain. So what are the risk factors basically? So anything which has caused some head trauma, maybe single or repetitive, any history of head concussion, any sport injury or while playing the following sports like boxing, football, soccer, wrestling, hockey, or military services, which causes usually blast injuries. So the length of sport participation is also important. Epileptics, so mainly when a person has seizure, that person may fall and hit his head to the ground, which may cause some concussion. So victims of domestic abuse, they suffer from coup and counter-coup injuries. And the age of injuries, younger people, they are more prone to CTE in later ages than the older ages. And genetic variation. So there are two alleles, APOE3 and APOA4, associated with CTE that have been found. And these are also associated with Alzheimer's disease. So I guess these are disorders, they go hand in hand. So there is a boxer who actually claims himself from suffering from the signs of early CTE. His name is Jake Paul, I'm including in the picture. So what is the clinical presentation? So there are broad range of very non-specific behavioral and cognitive changes that can occur. They usually include tremors, paranoia, confusion, aggression, depression, memory loss, speaking issues, impaired judgment, so on and so forth. So the history usually includes repetitive blows to the head, and the onset of behavior changes can be years to decades following the head injury, and the course of progression is very variable also. So as the condition further progresses, the signs and symptoms may include headaches, significant memory problems, motor symptoms including gait instability, slowness, that is bradykinesia, coordination difficulties, tremors, slurred speech, dysarthria, and dysphagia, and sleep disorders like obstructive sleep apnea, REM sleep disorder, rapid eye movement sleep disorder. So there are actually four stages that have been found, and every stage has its own symptoms which shows. So stage one, there are very few like brain injury, and there are basically no symptoms that are seen. But stage three, it can have like rage, impulsivity, and depression. And there's some accumulation of the tau protein, which is basically the pathology of TB. And stage three causes confusion and memory loss when the patient enters stage three. And it has more of the deposition of tau protein. And stage four, the patient will show advanced dementia. So there is a lot of accumulation of tau protein along with atrophy of the brain. So here I have quantified like the progression of the disease. So like in first, the acute concussion, the symptoms take place from days to weeks, and they include headache, blurred vision, amnesia, tinnitus, fatigue, and slurred speech. And then the patient goes into a post-concussive syndrome, which may last from 3 months to several years. And in addition to the previous symptoms, the patient person may have physical or emotional or cognitive problems. And then if this post-concussive syndrome becomes permanent, then the patient is labeled as CP, and he may experience poor concentration, attention, and memory, disorientation, dizziness, headaches, violent and aggressive behavior, confusion, speech abnormalities, and suicidal tendencies also. So now we'll talk about the gross pathology. So basically on CT, nothing can be found in gross pathology because MRIs, they're not very sensitive to detect such minute changes. And like contusion, diffuse axonal injury, small vascular lesion, atrophy. But there is a microscopic pathology related to CT. The basic feature is the presence of sparse, moderate, band-shaped or flame-shaped neurofibrillary tangles that are called NFTs in the brain, accompanied by neurofilled threads. So these are the pathognomic hallmark of the CT, and they can be found only when we do an autopsy of the brain, not before that. So now the areas of damage. So the gross findings that can be seen during the autopsy is reduced brain weight with atrophy of the frontal lobe, temporal lobe, parietal lobe, or occipital lobe. There's enlargement of the lateral or third ventricle. And there's thinning of the corpus callosum. Cavern septum pellucidum has fenestration in it, scarring and neuronal loss of cerebral tonsils, and pallor of the substantia nigra, which may cause the Parkinsonian-like symptoms. And then the other list is actually, I'll explain it better in the coming slides. So there's a direct clinico-pathological correlation between the symptom and the area of the brain that has been affected. So here, so the damaged area and the clinical presentation is shown. So if the area of damage is hippocampus, entorhinal cortex or medial thalamus, the patient will have early deficit in memory. If the area of damage is frontal cortex and underlying white matter, the person will present with dysexecutive symptoms like personality changes or judgment impairment. And if the area of damage is parietal, temporal, or occipital lobes, then the person may exhibit visuospatial difficulties. So if the area of damage is substantia nigra or pars compacta, then he may present with Parkinsonian motor features. And if the area of damage is cerebellum or brainstem or cortical damage, then he may have gait disorders like staggered, slow, or ataxic gait. And if the area of damage is some nuclei in the brainstem like hypoglossal or oculomotor, then he may have dysarthria or dysphagia or oculomotor abnormalities. And violent or aggressive behavior is seen when the area of damage is amygdala. Next slide. So the diagnosis. Currently, the only way to definitely diagnose CT is through post-mortem pathological autopsy. So this is a very beautiful slide showing the sections. So in the first image, there is a gross brain which shows, which when cut through the coronal plane reveals ventromegaly in the B image. And there are fenestrations in the septum pellucidum. And in the other slides, C, D, and E, it shows the deposition of the hyperphosphorylated tau, which is the pathognomic feature of the CTE. And it shows the neurofibrillary tangles and the tau pathology, basically. And then, so the clinical diagnosis is difficult due to lack of the consensus on diagnostic criteria. And there's a large-scale clinical pathological correlation study that has not been done. So we cannot diagnose a patient, a living patient, basically. So, and also the differential diagnoses for CTE are many, like Alzheimer's disease or frontotemporal dementia, because they all show the same clinical symptoms, and they may also have a history of head trauma, making the clinical diagnosis very difficult. Although age can help in distinguishing between Alzheimer's disease and CTE, it doesn't help deciding between frontotemporal dementia and CTE. So these are the two images. The first image, so this was actually a news which came a couple of months ago, that they diagnosed the first CT patient in a living patient, and eventually was found to have ALS also. So after he died, he was confirmed to have CT and ALS during while he was living. So that is also an overlapping diagnosis. So there are some advancements in the imaging that can aid in diagnosing. So advances in neuroimaging will aid, and so one of the scans is diffusion tensor imaging scan that is reported to be sensitive enough to assess axonal integrity in the setting of mild, moderate, or severe traumatic brain injury. Studies have shown the ability to show occult white matter damage after minor traumatic brain injury that was not visible on typical MRI. So this is a picture of diffuse tensor imaging. Now, there are PET scans available that are tau sensitive, but also tau is also found in other conditions like Alzheimer's and other neurodegenerative disease. So it's not very particular for CT, not very specific. But these can be done in living individuals. So at least we'll know that this patient might have CT. So the pathognomic lesion of CT consists of hyperphosphorylated tau that is aggregated in neurons, astrocytes, and cell processes around small vessels. And that occurs in irregular patterns at the depth of the cortical sulci. So in the image A, you see a small lesion, but as the images, as the progression takes place, there's advancement in and this diffuse deposition of the P tau. So why is there a progressive decline? The cumulative clinical neuropathological consequence of repeated head trauma overlap heavily with CTE. But what about the progressive decline when a person stops playing? So why CTE progresses years after a person stops playing? So that is because of the tau protein. So basically, tau protein is found abundantly in our neurons, and it serves to stabilize microtubules, which are essential in axonal transport and metabolism. Once these axons are damaged, the tau protein is released, which can self-assemble and aggregate and tangles of the filament and tangles in the filament. So it is found in Alzheimer's disease, frontotemporal dementia, progressive supranuclear palsy, corticobasal degeneration. So it can also be released in the extracellular space and can enter other cells and cause further aggregation. So it is kind of a vicious cycle. So once this is released, it will cause other cells also to release more tau protein, and it will accumulate and aggregate. Thus, traumatic brain injury results in loss of tau's normal function and gain of a pathological function. Additional factors such as chronic inflammation may exacerbate the altered tau dynamics. So there's a picture which shows once a traumatic brain injury is caused, so the beta amyloid accumulation and the tau protein is released, which further causes cerebrovascular damage, and they are contributing factors which causes more release of the tau could be, thus enhancing the injury. So the stages. So give four stages of the chronic traumatic encephalopathy. Stage one, they are very small lesions of P tau accumulating in the depths of the sulca and cerebral cortex. Stage two is when they are more than three lesions in multiple cortical
Are you still there?
Yeah. Hello?
Hello?
Somebody's microphone is on. Try, keep going. Did anybody in the office turn on an extra microphone?
Hello.
I'm sorry, what's going on here? Hang on, let's see if I can fix it someplace else here. Oh. I don't see it. I can't see a problem. Oh, I see here. AMI acute rotations has a microphone on. Can you silence it? There's two rotations going on here. One mic. Okay, that's okay now. Go ahead, please, Dr. Carr.
Okay. Yes, doctor.
That's fine now.
So there are four stages of CTE that are found in autopsy. So the stage one, it includes one or two lesions of CTE, that is the P tau lesions, that are deposited in the depth of the sulci or the cortex. Stage two includes more than three CTE lesions in multiple cortical regions and NFTs along with sulci wall and chiral crest. Stage three, there are widespread lesions, all widespread deposited along the medial temporal lobes or parietal lobes. And stage four, there is widespread p-tau deposition along with atrophy of the lobes and neuronal loss and meiosis. So what is the prevention and the treatment? So clearly the easiest way to decrease the incidence of CTE is to decrease the number of concussions. In athletes, this is accomplished by limiting the exposure to trauma. And for example, by penalizing the intentional hits to the head and adhering to the strict return to play guidelines. So we need proper care and management of mild traumatic brain injury, which in future will reduce the progression to CTE, along with improving the protective equipment worn by the athletes. So it has been shown that helmets and mouth guards function very well in protecting the player from severe head injury. So how is CTE treated? Because CTE can only be diagnosed once the person has died, the treatment can be very challenging. And the treatment for people who have symptoms of CTE include behavioral therapies to deal with mood swings, pain management, including medicines, massage, and acupuncture, to relieve the discomfort, memory exercise to strengthen the ability to recall daily activities. So the people who learn ways to deal with symptoms of CTE often have improved the quality of life, including less pain, improved memory, and fewer mood swings. So there's a gist of management that I've included. So first is a symptomatic management, and we need a multidisciplinary approach to treat the patient. And also there should be surveillance of the suicidal tendencies, because most of these people, they end up committing suicide and they can pose threat to their friends and relatives and the people besides them. So access to behavioral and counseling services is very important. And routine neurocognitive, neuropsychiatric, and functional capacity evaluation is done for these people, should be done for these people to assess the level of the CTE. So pharmacological management, as CTE is a neurocognitive disorder, so the medicines that can be used are SSRI, atypical antipsychotics, and cholinesterase inhibitor. which help in managing different behavioral and cognitive problems. So currently there is no disease modifying treatment just for CTE. Studies have demonstrated a potential effect, humble effect for cholinesterase inhibitor in helping the cognitive symptoms of traumatic tendency. So medicine that should be avoided in patients with CTE are the ones which have strong anticholinergic side effects, such as antihistaminics, barbiturates, narcotics, benzodiazepines, GI and urinary antispasmodics, CNS stimulants, muscle relaxants, and TCAs. And antipsychotics should be used with caution. If used carefully, carefully evaluate the effectiveness of the medication and consider discontinuing if there is no improvement in 6 weeks. So we have to make sure that we review the expected and realistic goals of the treatment, as there is no cure for this disease and the treatment is only symptomatic. So non-pharmacological management, it includes a healthy lifestyle. So a combination of good nutrition, physical activity, and mental and social engagement may provide benefit in promoting health. A heart healthy diet that includes low in sugar, fat, and higher in vegetables and fruit is also considered good for brain apart from the body. So that should be routinely followed. Then sleep. A disturbed sleep can negatively impact memory and thinking. So sleep hygiene should be strictly followed in order to decrease the progression of the disease. So there are some newer advancements in the treatment, which are still under research. So first is the immunotherapy. Monoclonal antibody therapy is one of the most common promising strategies. So the main pathology of CTE is the tau accumulation. So what this immunotherapy will do, that it will target, it will make target specific antibodies which will not accumulate the tau protein, thus preventing the disease to progress. And then there is kinase inhibitor. So because it is a protein, it will need phosphorylation to make the neurofibrillary tangles and everything. So if we stop the phosphorylation at various sites, we can prevent the formation of NFTs and tau. So tau hyperphosphorylation can occur at 8 or more sites. Each could be therapeutically targeted via kinase inhibition, thus preventing the progression of the disease. But these two are still under research. And so then what is the outlook of for people with chronic traumatic encephalopathy? So most of the people who show signs of CTE, they live a healthy and fulfilling life. Regular exercises, good nutrition can help manage patients, including pain and stress levels. So people can use many strategies to deal with the behavioral symptoms. These include establishing a daily routine and making notes, which will help combat them memory problems. Relaxation methods such as deep breathing will control emotions. And sharing challenges with friends and family, I think, could be very helpful. And they'll ease the load. Sometimes professional counseling can be very helpful in managing the symptoms also. So this is a gist of what all I have said. So chronic traumatic encephalopathy, as it says, progressive degeneration of the brain. And there are various stages. The stage one will mainly affect your memory, social instability. Stage two may progress to Parkinson's disease. Stage three is general cognitive impairment, which worsens with dementia. And there are many athletes who have actually died from CTE. I've mentioned, but I don't know any of these. I don't watch cricket or sport. So what are the research barriers in CTE? As the disease is a very slow progressive disease. It takes decades long lag between injury and symptoms to occur. So we don't know if I hit my head today, I don't know if I'll ever get CTE or something. You never know. There's a long gap between the injury and the symptom. And diagnosis is only possible after death. So that is also one big thing that limits the treatment and the management of the disease. And there are very few treatments that are available for CTE. So these are all things that could be a good research opportunity. So this is the last slide. So there's a take-home message, as I think this is a repetition of everything that I've just said. I'll just read the last sentence. So current research is attempting to identify specific biomarkers along with more sophisticated imaging techniques for the diagnosis and management of CT while a patient is still alive. That is, I think, more important. Thank you.